And welcome to Tharaka Foundation's YouTube channel, Supporting the Whole Child. We just wanted to give you a quick disclaimer saying that everything that is found on our YouTube channel is created for informational purposes only. It is not intended to be a substitute for professional medical advice, diagnosis, or treatment. Always seek the advice of your physician or other qualified health provider with any questions you may have regarding a medical condition, and never disregard professional medical advice or delay in seeking it because of something that you have heard or seen on this YouTube channel. Thank you so much, and without further ado, let's begin today's video.
Hello everyone, welcome to the Tharaka Foundation YouTube channel, Supporting the Whole Child. I am your host, Poonam. I do have Dr. Leena with me. We started a series on depression, and if you remember, during the last episode, Dr. Leena did educate us about the type of depression. And today we would like to know more about the causes and then follow up with our treatment discussion. So Dr. Leena, take it away.
Thank you again for having me, Poonam. So, you know, we talked about what is depression, what are the different symptoms we look for to diagnose somebody with clinical depression in the last episode. So, you know, today we can talk about what causes depression, since it's something we are seeing more commonly happening more and more in today's world. There's often this question that comes to everyone's mind, why does this happen? There are a few different causes identified. It can happen because of genetics. So if it runs in your family, if you have parents or grandparents or siblings, you know, first degree relatives, as we call them, like more immediate family members, if they have struggled with something like that, then you are at a higher likelihood of having depression, just like, you know, any other medical condition like diabetes or high blood pressure, which often run in families. There can be medical causes for depression. So when I have a patient come in for evaluation of depression, I'm always ruling out medical causes first, because there are certain medical conditions that can, you know, mimic depression or have symptoms like depression. And you may think that it is related to more psychological factors, but it's actually related to more like biological factors or medical, you know, physical factors. So there are conditions like hypothyroidism, the condition where your thyroid hormone is not being secreted enough and your levels are low. So people with hypothyroidism also feel sad and depressed. They can feel lethargic or tired. They can have a lot of other common symptoms like decreased motivation, decreased interest in things. And then, of course, there are a few other symptoms that we, you know, look into, and then if it raises a red flag, like maybe people with hypothyroidism often have, you know, what we call as intolerance to cold. They get cold very easily. Along with that, they may have constipation issues. If they have dry skin and hair loss, those can be additional symptoms. So if I am hearing some of these symptoms along with like the mood symptoms, then it raises a red flag. And not that everybody has to have other symptoms. Sometimes some person can expect or experience only few symptoms that are more emotional or psychological. And even that can be a good indicator for us to rule out if it's related to thyroid abnormality. So we order blood tests to look at thyroid levels, and that's the way to rule out that it's related to it or not. Often for, you know, teen girls, you know, they tend to have a higher risk to develop what we call as anemia, which is this loss of hemoglobin levels or your iron levels in the blood, which can also present with feeling really down, feeling really tired, feeling really listless or, you know, lethargic. So that can be also a big cause for depression. And because young teen girls, if they've started their period and if they've been having heavy periods, often, you know, they may become anemic, and that could be driving the symptoms. Now, what I typically see is that if we look at these types of factors like thyroid issue or anemia, even low vitamin D levels, you know, we know that that's an important vitamin that helps us in a number of different things and also has its role in mood regulation. And that's something we get more when we are out in the sunshine. And so if you have low vitamin D levels, that can also attribute to depressive symptoms. So certain other nutritional deficiencies also can look like depression. But what we notice is typically it's a combination of physical factors along with psychological factors or psychological stress. So even if, you know, I am looking for these physical causes as like, are these adding to or attributing to depression, I am still going to treat the depression like I would treat otherwise. So even if I identify somebody having some low thyroid levels or low vitamin D levels, if their symptoms are pretty severe or if they have had a lot of, you know, other problems that they are experiencing, then it's coming in the way of their life, then we need to still treat depression like we do treat otherwise, along with treating their medical problem with supplementing the thyroid if it's a thyroid issue, giving them iron pills for low iron causing anemia, or giving them vitamin D, things like that. So usually, depending on how the level of severity of symptoms is, we still include both the medical as well as psychological treatment for that. Then there are other causes also, like substances or external, you know, drugs that can cause depression. In, you know, in our world of teens today, we do see that they are exposed to a lot of these things earlier on. They definitely are easily getting access to things like nicotine or vaping or marijuana or alcohol, and sometimes even other harder drugs, which can be even more concerning. And I want to take a minute to kind of talk about how this is a vicious cycle. So, you know, a lot of the times your child might get exposed to one of these substances because of peer pressure, or because of if they are at this age of novelty seeking, so they want to try something new. And then in combination with that, if peer pressure tells them to like try this, they go ahead and try that. Often we see that, you know, your friend might catch you at that vulnerable period when you're under a lot of stress and say, oh, you're stressed about that test tomorrow. Let's go and have a puff of, you know, this thing, or like have a few puffs of this e-cigarette that I have, and let's vape together, or let's smoke a joint together of the cannabis or marijuana. And it may start there as like, oh, it's a escape. It's an escape, or it's, you know, like a thing we can do to have fun, and it's recreational and it's safe and it's nothing bad. And that's kind of how, unfortunately, people get into that. Understandably, like that's an age where the impulse control ability is much lower. So kids are more vulnerable to that kind of novelty seeking behavior. So it may start like that. And they may feel in the moment after they smoke that they are feeling a little more relaxed or not as stressed or not as sad. And it gives them a false impression that this is a quick fix, that this can help me, you know, feel better quickly. And so they often go back to that. Or it may be like, oh, I'm doing this as a fun thing with my friend every now and then, and they build upon that. But what we understand that is, even though these substances in the moment might make you feel lighter or less anxious or less stressed, actually, in the long run, the more you use, they mess up your brain chemistry, which is what we understand is the ultimate reason for these types of conditions like anxiety and depression. So we have neurotransmitters in our brain. There is a couple that have been identified, that is serotonin and norepinephrine. And even sometimes we consider dopamine as an important one when it comes to depression. And so if I am, you know, trying to get momentarily, you know, pleasure from just doing stuff, we understand that there is actually a cost that you're paying, because over time, your neurochemical imbalance of these neurotransmitters is getting affected, which in turn can attribute to causation of anxiety and or depression symptoms. So this is an important thing I cannot emphasize, that, you know, we need to also rule out when we are assessing somebody for depression, because there is a category of diagnosis that we call as substance-induced mood disorder that exists. So we have seen enough times, you know, teens or young adults who may have depression presentation or depression-like symptoms because of their constant drug use or alcohol use. And, you know, in those instances, we recommend them going off the drug for 4 weeks to actually wash away the impact of substance. That's roughly how much time it takes fully to take away that impact on the neurotransmitter level. And 4 weeks later, they might clear up completely. Sometimes we'll be surprised that, oh my gosh, like it was all related to their drug use. So it's fairly common. And then we do see this vicious pattern. Sometimes after stopping the drugs for 4 weeks, they may be less depressed than they were, but they may have some baseline anxiety or depression that gets more recognized. And it is an understanding that they are trying to use drugs to feel better because they've been not doing well or feeling, you know, unhappy. And but it's a very bad vicious cycle you get in. You're self-medicating yourself to treat the anxiety and or depression by using these substances. And then these substances in turn mess up your brain chemistry more and make these symptoms worse. More often than not, we see this happening more and more as these substances have become more commonly available to teens, and we have to really work a lot on breaking this vicious cycle to get them better. Besides the few things that I already talked about, so genetics, physical or medical conditions like, you know, thyroid, vitamin D deficiency, and anemia, substances, there is also understanding if we have psychological stress, like trauma or any adverse experiences or a lot of stressful events in our life, then even that can over time cause neurotransmitter imbalance and leads to symptoms of depression. So those are the common ones that we really look for.
Thank you, Dr. Leena, for sharing in detail what could be the cause of depression. So I was thinking about one question, like you were saying, it's a vicious cycle for 4 weeks if they are sober, but it can happen again. So what parents need to watch for and how parents can support in this situation to their teens so that it doesn't happen again?
That's a very good question, Poonam. So as parents, of course, you need to be more vigilant and understand what your child is doing. If you notice any change in their behavior where you get a hint of they might be smoking, you know, a lot of the times parents tell us that they can sense the smell from, you know, the child walking into the house, or if they go to their room and they check a few things or look at their backpack, sometimes they may find a pipe or a, you know, vaping device or whatnot. So keeping your radars up, because, you know, we understand this age is kind of very precarious, and they are at this novelty seeking phase, and they may want to do things that they don't intend to, but they do it anyways because of peer pressure. So even keeping track of the company they keep and what kind of things they are doing when they meet these friends and who they are hanging out with, what are their ways to have fun. So keeping tabs on those things. And then if you do find out that, oh, my child is actually, you know, has slipped in this direction or has been abusing some of these things, then definitely taking charge and allowing them to kind of come back on a more healthy path again. And again, it doesn't need to be done punitively. I mean, a lot of the times we see it's a very big concern for parents, so they can get very reactive and they can say you are grounded and you're never going to now go out for this or that and you can't see your friends. What we understand is those types of very extreme punitive methods in the very beginning, at least as a first step, can be not very helpful. Trying to empathize with them and understand why and, you know, what's the cause for this? Is this just peer pressure? Is this something they are struggling, you know, emotionally with and they are trying to get help as a self-medication? Or are they, you know, in search of something that will take away their stress, and what could be other healthier ways to teach them to manage stress? Those are some of the things to like explore with your child and then give them the guidance to, you know, steer away from that path. Sometimes, of course, you know, parents need help of professionals to do this because it can be a strain in the relationship that can get further worse because of these types of conversations with your child. So, you know, having a neutral person, a mental health professional who can help you guide the boundaries around how are you going to manage this with your child, what kind of consequences would they expect, and having like a really good guidance around how to approach this. If the child needs more help, like they need to join a rehab program of some kind or support group where they can get more support to feel more motivated to quit. Sometimes that's involved in this. So there are, you know, various different ways, but I think the most important thing the parents need to do is to keep an eye and still stay calm and handle this in a calm fashion rather than being reactive, because, you know, we often find that's an approach where kids will comply to more than the more of reactive or punitive approach.
I understand that, Dr. Leena. To summarize, like as you said, there are PHQ-9 form available. So generally during the physical activity, maybe doctor will evaluate or ask. But in general, parents should keep an eye on the child behavior, and if they feel something is not going right, kid is like, you know, snapping or eating habits are changing or sleeping patterns are different. So all that could be a reason of having some mental health issues. So during that time, parents should definitely take the help from a mental health provider instead of ignoring it. So that you know, the right thing can be done at the right time. So I definitely would like to understand more about the treatment part. Like we understood the causes, right? So I am sure there are good treatments available for all these reasons. And then we may even talk about prevention, because as you said, some of these things are vicious, and yeah, you can be treated one time. What if it happens again? So we need to be also taking some preventive action so that we are reforming these kind of things for the long term, not for just the short term. Because as you said, you know, peer pressure will be there, situations will be there, ups and downs of the life will be there. But how do we build our resilient children, right? So I think it's a wonderful cause of Tarika Foundation, and you're helping us a lot to educate ourselves and have that whole child experience. Thank you so much for sharing your knowledge with us.
Thank you.